Hey folks, my name is Utkarsh Upadhyay and welcome you to Analog Electronics and Circuits Lecture 7. Okay, so I request you to please hit the like button if you really like the video, share and subscribe to our channel and write down your comments below in the comment section so that we can help you out with your doubts. Okay, now in the last lecture we ended our discussion with the IDE diode average current. Okay, we basically that incorporated the derivation of the average current that flows across the diode. Okay, now in this lecture we asked this lecture starts with the discussion of the peak current across the diode, the peak current that flows across the diode. So this was your sixth point of discussion. Okay, so this will be your peak diode current or maximum diode current, you can say maximum diode current. Okay, so let's begin this lecture. Hopefully you must have gone through all the lectures that I covered before so that you are well versed with the concepts that I covered in the past 6 lectures. If you are not done with the last lectures, in the last 6 lectures, please go through those 6 lectures and then come at 7th lecture. Otherwise you won't be able to get the real essence of this subject. So try to get the real essence of the subject since the beginning of this subject. Okay, so we define it as it is the sum of peak capacitor current, peak capacitor current and peak load current. Okay, when we did not connect the capacitor at the output of the half wave rectifier, the peak diode current would be equal to the peak load current. Okay, because there would not be any current peak current flowing through the capacitor because the capacitor was not there. Okay, so we can write it in the form of equation. So ID peak will be equal to IC peak plus IDC, because the peak current that is flowing across the load resistance RL will be equal to IDC. So load current almost remains constant. It does not change. Okay, so what you have that now, ID peak will be equal to, now when we would basically get the maximum capacitor current, so we can say it is IC at T is equal to minus delta T plus IDC. When we had our discussion of finding out the conduction interval, we basically drew the input voltage waveform like this, which was a cosinusoidal form. Now when t is equal to minus delta t, the capacitor basically starts charging up to the maximum value. Okay, and for this particular duration of delta t, your VCT was equal to Vm sine, or you can say Vm cos omega naught t. Okay, and at t is equal to minus delta t, we had this thing equal to Vm minus Vr is equal to Vm cos omega naught minus delta t. Okay, now at this, so when your capacitor current will be maximum, when the capacitor is fully charged or the maximum or charged up to the maximum value, the current would be minimum. Okay, when the capacitor is charged to the maximum value, the current would be minimum. So the current would be maximum when it just starts charging. So at t is equal to minus delta t, your capacitor current will be maximum, because at this time your capacitor starts charging. And when the capacitor fully charged, when the capacitor is fully charged, or it is charged to the maximum possible value, the current will be minimum. So this can be written as C dv by dt, because we know that t is equal to minus delta t plus idc. Okay. Now your C d by dt of this will be Vm cos omega naught t at t is equal to minus delta t plus idc, as I already mentioned here that it will be equal to Vm cos omega naught t. Okay, so if you just differentiate this thing up, you get C omega naught Vm. Differentiation of cos will be minus sign. You have minus sign omega naught t at t is equal to minus delta t plus idc. Okay, this will be C omega naught Vm sine omega naught delta t plus idc. Is it clear? This will be your id peak. Okay, so if we further solve this, since omega naught delta t is very small, this just for the approximation purpose, we are just approximating this thing. So we can say that sine omega naught delta t will be equal to omega naught delta t. So your id peak will be equal to C omega naught Vm omega naught delta t plus idc. Okay, so this will be equal to C Vm omega naught square delta t plus idc. Understood? So we can say this will be equal to C Vm omega naught. Now what is omega naught delta t? Omega naught delta t is 2 Vr by square root of 2 Vr by Vm plus idc. Okay, since we know that omega naught delta t is the conduction angle, it is equal to square root of 2 Vr by Vm. Okay, so this will be equal to, if you further solve this thing, we know that it will be equal to idc by f naught Vr into Vm omega naught square root 2 Vr by Vm plus idc. This will be equal to idc into 2 pi square root of 2 Vm by Vr plus idc. Understood? Because it will be when Vr square, this will cancel out the Vm by Vr. We take this in the square root, it will be equal to 2 Vm by Vr. So when you solve, so id peak comes out to be equal to idc into 1 plus 2 pi square root of 2 Vm by Vr. So this will be your id peak. Just in case, I just want to tell you that this is only, this equation can only be used if you see a capacitor connected at the output of a half wave rectifier. Otherwise it cannot be used. Otherwise this term will be equal to zero, an id peak or id average. Okay, if a capacitor filter is not considered, your id peak and id average will be equal to idc, because this is the maximum or the average possible current that is flowing through resistor RL. Okay, understood? So this is the thing that you should remember. Now I just want you to make a note here. Now we studied that, we saw that PIV of a half wave rectifier is equal to Vm, which is smaller than that in the case of standard type full wave rectifier. So note is, if RL is now disconnected, capacitor cannot discharge, okay, and will basically attain a steady state value of Vm, and attains a steady or constant value of Vm. So PIV of the diode, it comes out to be equal to 2 Vm. Now if we see the second transform, the secondary winding of the transformer and the capacitor here, so we have now disconnected your resistance RL. RL is now disconnected. Okay, this RL is now disconnected. RL is tend to infinity. RL is now disconnected. So the capacitor basically cannot discharge. So if you see, the diode is used to is connected like this. Okay, so when Vm is positive, this is your Vi. Okay, this is your Vi. The capacitor will basically attain a maximum value of Vm, because when it initially charges through diode D, when it is forward biased, the capacitor charges through the diode D and attains a steady state constant value of Vm. Okay, this will be short circuited in that case. Now when Vi is basically, now what is PIV? PIV is peak inverse voltage. It just tells you the how much maximum possible reverse voltage that the diode can bear. Okay, maximum possible voltage that the diode can bear. So we have to think that we have to take the extreme case. So when Vi is basically at its minima, that is minus Vm. When Vi is at its minima, that is attains a minimum value, that is basically minus Vm, which is this. We are talking about this particular value, which is minus Vm. Okay, this is plus Vm. Then only we can say we shall be able to find out the maximum possible voltage that the diode can bear. So your PIV, so we can say this will be your PIV, peak inverse voltage. So at that point, what we can say, if we apply the KVL in this loop, it will be equal to minus Vm plus V diode peak minus Vm is equal to zero. Sorry, this will be also be minus. So V diode peak will be equal to minus 2 Vm. So PIV will be equal to magnitude of minus 2 Vm. This will be equal to 2 Vm. So we can say that the PIV is equal to 2 Vm. Okay, this is important to note down. Understand? So this is the peak inverse voltage is equal to 2 Vm in the case when we connect a capacitor filter at the output of a half rectifier and we disconnect RL, or RL tends to infinity. Okay, understood. So now let's have a look at some examples based on the concept that we covered till now. Okay, so let's have a look at this question. A half wave rectifier with a capacitor filter supplies 30 volt to the load of 500 ohm. Okay, supply the 30 volt to a load of 500 ohm. If ripple factor R is 0.01 and frequency of AC supply is 50 hertz, which is f0, calculate the value of capacitance, average and peak diode currents. Now what are we available with? We are given VDC FL, or you can say VDC normal is 30 volts, which is at the resistance RL. Now RL is given as 500 ohms. If ripple factor, now we are given the ripple factor as 0.01 and frequency or frequency if not is given as 50 hertz. Calculate the frequency of capacitance. Calculate the value of capacitance, ID peak and ID average. Okay, now since we know VDC, we can find out IDC. IDC will be equal to VDC by RL. Okay, VDC will be equal to 30 volt upon RL is 500. We get, okay, this will be your IDC, this is in amperes. Okay, now we know that ripple factor is 1 by 2 root 3 F naught C RL. As we already know, the ripple factor for a half wave rectifier with the capacitor filter is this. Now we know this is equal to 0.01. Okay, now what do we know in this? What can we find out from this expression? Now we know capacitance will be equal to 1 by 2 root 3 F naught RL into 0.01. We know all the values. We can easily find your capacitance value. 2 root 3 into 50 hertz into RL, load resistance is 500 ohms into 0.01. If you solve for this, you get the capacitance value as 1.15 millifarad. Okay, this is the capacitance value. Second, it is asked to find out the ID average value. So we know that ID average is IDC into 1 plus pi square root of 2 Vm by Vr. Now we need to find out the ripple voltage. Okay, we need to find out the ripple voltage. How can we do that? Now we know that VDC is basically equal to Vm minus Vr by 2. Okay, your okay, so we know, or using this thing, or we can also do this. We know Vr is equal to IDC by F naught C. Yeah, we can solve with this. IDC, we know it is equal to 0.06, which was 30 by 500, and F naught will be equal to 50, and the capacitance value is 1.15 into 10 to the power minus 3, which we just found. So Vr, which we have just found. So this, if we solve for this, you get 1.04 volts. Okay, now using this and plugging this thing in this equation, so we know we need to find out the value of Vm as well, now. So we can say that Vm, now we can say that Vm is equal to VDC plus Vr by 2. Okay, so VDC. Now what is VDC? VDC we have already calculated. What is VDC? VDC is we given is 30 volts. VDC is 30 volts plus 1.04 by 2, and this comes out to be 30.52 volts. Okay, now we can easily calculate your ID average. So ID average will be equal to, now so your ID average will be equal to IDC into 1 plus pi square root of 2 Vm by Vr. What is Vm? Vm is 30.52 by Vr. Vr will be is 1.04, and if you solve for this, you get ID average value being 1.504 ampere. Okay, this is your ID average value. Similarly, you can find out ID peak using the formula IDC to 1 plus 2 pi square root of 2 Vm by Vr. Plug in the values, you can solve this particular expression. You can easily find that out. Okay, let me just solve this for you. Since it is a solved example, so your ID peak will be equal to, now IDC is basically 3 by 50, and this is basically 1 plus 2 pi square root of 2 Vm is 330.52 by Vr is 1.04, and if you solve for this, you get 2.95 ampere. This is your ID peak. Now you must be wondering that a diode basically can only withstand the currents of the order of milliampere or microampere or milliampere, but this is very large current for a diode to bear. This 2.95, nearly 3 ampere current is flowing through the resistance through the diode D. Now this is a very huge value. Now you and then usually diodes basically can bear the currents up to the order of milliampere or microampere, but this is very large current. this is basically a very, very large current. This is basically a very large current. So we can say that the capacitor basically draws a large current from diode, because the current across the load resistance RL is constant, and that is equal to IDC. What is basically determining this this magnitude of current is basically the capacitor. Capacitor is basically the only candidate which is basically drawing a huge amount of current through the resistor, through the diode R, through the diode D, because the current IDC, which is across the load resistance RL, is almost constant, and that is a constant at IDC, and that's the, and the capacitor is the left the only candidate which is drawing, which could be a possible reason for drawing the this huge current from the diode. So this current is basically known as a surge current. So I just want to make a note of this, okay, so that this is a very important point. Generally the diodes now, so if you basically design a half rectifier with the capacitor filter, it is highly recommended that the diode has a greater current rating. So here you can say, when the capacitor charges through diode, it will draw a strong current, through the diode. Okay, it is called as surge current. Okay, so that's only for a delta T duration, because in that delta T duration the capacitor basically charges through diode D. So if you see this thing, this is basically your ID peak, and this is the amount of current that this capacitor draws through a diode D. So this is basically your ID peak value, this is basically your ID peak value, and this is basically your y-axis is ID I diode. Okay, so this is basically ID peak value, and this is for the duration of delta T, because for this particular duration your diode, your capacitor basically charges and draws a huge amount of current, which is in the order of amperes. Okay, so diode conducts for delta T time, and capacitor charges in that duration. So diode basically, so capacitor draws heavy current from diode. So what are the points that we should note down? That we should take care of before designing a half-wave rectifier with a capacitor filter? First thing is that diode should have greater PIV, or you can say reverse voltage rating, which is greater than 2 VM, as we already saw that the PIV across the diode is 2 VM. Second, diode should have greater current rating because charging current of capacitor or surge current is very strong. Okay, so that the diode does not destroy, does not devoured of an immediate requirement of large amount of current of the capacitor by the capacitor. Okay, understood? Understand. Now let's have a look at another example. A half-wave rectifier uses, let me change the color of the pen. So it says a half-wave rectifier uses a capacitor of 500 microfarad. So what are we available with is this capacitance of 500 microfarad in parallel to a load of 1 kilo ohm. So we have RL equal to 1 kilo ohm. If the average output voltage, so we have VDC is equal to 48 volt. This is nothing but VDCFL. Okay, 48 volt, and frequency of AC supply is 60 Hertz. So we are given F naught as 60 Hertz. Calculate peak to peak and RMS ripple. So now first of all, peak to peak ripple. Okay, now we know that VDC is 48 volt. Okay, and F naught is 50 Hertz. We can find out your IDC is BDC by RL, which is nothing but 48 by 1, which is equal to 48 milliamperes. Okay, 48 milliampere. So what is meant by peak to peak ripple? Peak to peak ripple is basically VR. So we know VR will be equal to IDC by F naught C. So here IDC is 48 milliampere upon F naught is 60 Hertz into capacitance is 500 into 10 to power minus 6. So if you solve for this, you get it as 1.6 volt. Now, second one is RMS ripple. So we have the RMS ripple. Okay, your RMS ripple will be equal to VRMS prime. RMS ripple is VRMS prime is the pure AC component. VRMS prime. So we can say VRMS prime is equal to VR upon 2√3. As we already saw in the last lecture, its derivation in the last lecture, and this has already been discussed in the last lecture, what is VR by 2√3. This will equal to 1.6 upon 2√3. If you solve for this, you get 0.46 volt, and you can say it's basically falls in an approximate agreement with the ripple factor that we discussed about the half ripple factor of the half rectifier in the last 2 to 3 lectures, which was 0.483. we concluded that it is nearly equal to 0.483, so you can see it's an approximate agreement of that. Okay, the second one is ripple factor. Now we know what is ripple factor. Ripple factor will be equal to VRMS prime by VDC. Ripple factor is this, VRMS prime by VDC. Now VRMS prime will be equal to 0.46 upon VDC, that we already know. VDC is 48 volts. So 48 volts, you can easily conclude that it is equal to 9.58 into 10 to the power minus 3. Or you can solve it by using ripple factor 1 by 2√3 F naught C RL. Okay, so if we apply the same thing, 2√3 F naught is 60, 500 into 10 power minus 6 into RL is 1 kilo ohm, which is 10 to the power 3. You will get the same result. Okay, now the third one is angle of conduction. Now third point is angle of conduction. Omega naught delta t is the angle of conduction, and this is equal to square root of 2 VR by VM. Now we know the ripple voltage, but we do not know VM. How can we find that out? Now we know this thing, that VDC is basically VM minus VR by 2. We can say that VM is equal to VDC plus VR by 2. VDC is nothing but VDC is 48 volt plus VR. Now what is VR? VR is 1.6 by 2. So we get it as 48.8 volt. So we can conclude that omega naught delta t is equal to square root of 2 VR by VM as square root of 2 into 1.6 upon 48.8. If you solve for this, you get 0.256 radians. So this is the answer to this. Okay, understood? So these are a few examples based on a half wave rectifier with the capacitor filter. Now let's begin with the discussion of full wave rectifier, a center tet full wave rectifier with the capacitor filter. Okay, let's start with full wave rectifier with capacitor filter. Okay, most of the things are analogous to what we discussed in the case of half wave rectifier. So I shall not be derivating that much in this topic. So let me quickly draw the circuit diagram of a full wave rectifier with the capacitor filter. Okay, so we are drawing the center tapped full wave rectifier. This is basically a primary winding. This is basically a pure AC signal. It is basically a pure AC. Okay, from the power from the supply. This is a step down transformer. This is N1 is to N2. Okay, where N1 is greater than N2. And this is diode D1. This is diode D1. This is center tapped. Okay, this is grounded. And this is diode D2. Okay, and here we have a capacitor which is connected in parallel with the load resistance RL. This is the capacitor C. This is center tapped, and this is basically VA and VB. And we already saw that VA is equal to minus VB. We have already discussed this thing. And the output voltage here, VO, will be equal to your capacitance voltage VC. Okay, so we know that your VA will be equal to minus VB. If it is plus minus, this will be plus and minus. So VA will be equal to minus VB. Okay, now let's discuss the waveform of the whole circuit. Okay, now let's quickly discuss the overall waveform. This is basically your VA, and this will be, the next one will be VB. This will be your, let's say this is basically your VB. This is your VB. Okay, now this is basically, okay, this is basically your VM. This is basically your minus VM. Okay, VA is following VI, and VB is basically just negative of that. Now when VA is positive, if you just have a look, when VA is positive, when VI is positive, this is basically your overall VI, VA minus VB or VI. So you can see when this is, let's say this is plus minus, this is plus and minus. Okay, so when VA is equals to VM sin alpha, VA is equal to VM sin alpha, so you can say when diode D1 will be forward biased and VB will be negative, diode D2 will be reverse biased. So it will basically charge the capacitor. So the capacitor will basically charge through this thing. The capacitor basically charges up to here. At this point, when it reaches to the maximum value, what would happen, that your voltage VA will become less than, voltage VA will become less than the capacitance voltage, because RC time constant, we can say that RLC time constant is large. So discharging time constant, since it is very large, so VA becomes less than your capacitance voltage, then the capacitor basically starts discharging through RL up to the point when your VB becomes positive. When VB becomes positive, your diode D2 will be forward biased, and then it will start following your VB. At this particular point, what would happen? Your VB will become less than the capacitance voltage, and again the capacitor starts, and again the capacitor starts discharging through RL. And again your VA becomes positive. Okay, your diode D1 will be forward biased, it will follow your VA, and then after this particular point it will become less than that, again start, this process continues. So you can see that we are getting a rippled DC output, but the ripples are very less compared to that in the case of a half wave rectifier. Okay, the ripples are very less as compared to that in the case of a half wave rectifier. So you can say this is the rippled DC. You can say this thing is rippled DC output. This is a rippled DC output. Okay, so let's say this is basically your time T1. Okay, let's say this is basically your time T2. This is basically your time T3. And up to this point, this is T0. Up to this point, this is T0. Up to this particular point, it is T0. Okay, this is T0. Now, this time interval is T discharge. This is T discharge, and this time interval, which is up to here, this is T charge, and this interval from here to it is T0/2, because this from the blue peak point to the red peak point, it is T0/2. Okay, this is T0/2. So from here we can conclude that T discharge plus T charge is equal to T0/2. Is this clear? So let me just quickly write down the three cases here, which will be very helpful for you to understand. Okay, so, and again, this particular voltage is basically VA minus VR. Peak to peak ripple is VR. So for this particular interval, diode D1 conducts, and capacitor charges through D1, and up to a peak value of Vm. Then for this particular interval, for T less than T2, greater than T1, or T lying between T4 and T3, capacitor discharges slowly through RL, and capacitor voltage decreases by an amount of VR, which is the ripple voltage. During discharging interval, diodes remain in reverse bias. So diode remain in reverse bias mode. Okay, T4 is basically this. T4 is this particular interval. This is T4. Okay, so for the interval T lying between T3 and T2, for this particular interval, when it is charging, your D2 conducts, which means that it will be forward biased in this interval, and capacitor charges through diode D2 up to the peak input. This is literally analogous to the envelope detector, which we basically use to demodulate the amplitude modulated signal. Okay, this is analogous to that. This is how we perform the same. This is how we perform the same thing in the case of demodulating the amplitude AM signal. Okay, so you can see that the above process of rapid changing. Our process of rapid changing through D1 and D2 and slow discharging through RL keeps repeating, okay. So we already saw that T discharge plus T charge is equal to T naught by 2. Since T charge is very, very small, we can approximate T discharge nearly equal to T naught by 2. T discharge will be equal to T naught by 2 because T charge is very, very small, considering T charge to be very, very small. Okay, now let's perform the analysis. Let's start the analysis of a full wave rectifier with the capacitive filter. The first one is basically peak to peak ripple. So this basically again it requires the usage of the same concept that we used in the derivation of the peak to peak ripple for a half wave rectifier. So for that particular interval, we can for discharging so it is basically the law of conservation of charge. By following the law of conservation of charge, so charge lost by the capacitor is the equal to charge supplied to RL, load resistance RL. Charge lost by the capacitor for that duration. So what is the change in the voltage corresponding to the lost charge from the capacitor is equal to VR. So the change in the voltage across the capacitor corresponding to the loss of the charge through loss of the charge by the capacitor is equal to VR, and this will be equal to IDC into T discharge. IDC is equal to T discharge. The C into VR will be equal to IDC. I discharge, T discharge is T naught by 2. So we can say it will be equal to IDC T naught by 2C, or you can say VR will be equal to IDC by 2F0C. The ripple voltage that we got in the case of half wave rectifier was IDC by F0C. So you can say the ripple voltage, the peak to peak ripple voltage, is reduced by 2 times than in the case of half wave rectifier. It is reduced by 2 times than in the case of half wave rectifier, 1 by 2. Okay, is it clear? Understand. So this is basically your peak to peak ripple voltage. Okay, now let's have a look at another point of discussion. Second one is basically the ripple factor. Ripple factor, which is equal to R. Now we know what is ripple factor. Ripple factor Now ripple factor is basically VRMS prime by VDC. Now we know this thing that VRMS prime will be equal to VR by 2 root 3. Same concept, VR by 2 root 3. Okay, so we know that VRMS prime will be equal to 1 by 2 root 3. What is VR? IDC by 2F naught C. Okay, so we just IDC can be written as VDC into VDC divided by RL divided by 4 root 3 F naught C. So ripple factor will be equal to VRMS prime by VDC will be equal to 1 by 4 root 3 F naught C RL. Ripple factor in the case of a full wave rectifier has been reduced, is reduced by 2 times than in the case of half wave rectifier. So ripple factor is basically reduced by half, reduced to a half of its of the value of the to half of the ripple factor value in the case of half wave rectifier. So from here we can conclude ripple factor is reduced to half of the ripple factor in the case of a half wave rectifier. So this is a good thing. Okay folks, I am stopping this lecture here. Please go through this lecture carefully and try to understand each and every ounce of the important points that I covered in this lecture. And if you haven't gone through the last 6 lectures that I covered, please go through those first and then move on to this particular lecture. Otherwise you won't be able to get a real essence, the real essence of this particular subject. And this subject is very, very important with as per GATE, IES and PSUs, and also in the IIT MTech interviews. So thank you very much. Now also please hit the like button if you really like this video, share and subscribe to our channel, and write down the comments below in the comment section. Thank you very much.